So I always tell people that I think that racism against Mexicans is kind of dormant. You just need somebody to fan the flames a little bit, and then people believe it all over again.
Turmoil, prejudice, racism, and resistance. These barriers have always described the Mexican experience passing through the American border, but never more so than during the Mexican Revolution in the early 20th century. Between 1910 and 1930, the amount of Mexicans immigrating into the United States tripled. This surge of refugees triggered anti-immigrant sentiment and concerns that the war would spread over the border to affect Americans. The tension was felt in no place more than El Paso, a border city right across the Rio Grande from the Mexican city of Juarez. Each day, thousands of Mexican workers crossed the border to work in the United States and experienced the rising racial discrimination firsthand. One such worker was a woman named Carmelita Torres, whose leadership in the 1917 Bath Riots attempted to break social, political, and physical barriers of American hostility. Torres empowered Mexican immigrants to protest their maltreatment and inspired Mexican women to begin social political activism in the face of rampant sexism. Despite her efforts, these barriers were strengthened in the aftermath of the Mexican Revolution and World War I. Fear swept along the border in the early 20th century. The 1915 arrest of Mexican revolutionaries Victoriano Huerta and Pascual Orozco in New Mexico only helped to intensify the prejudice. Then, tensions reached a breaking point. On January 12, 1916, tragedy struck in Santa Isabel, Mexico. Border tensions reached a breaking point in the city of El Paso, Texas. In 1915, recently elected Mayor Tom Lee was obsessed with cleanliness. His vision of scrubbing the city clean of corruption, drugs, and minorities set the stage for years of social, political, and physical barriers for immigrants into the United States.
Hundreds of dirty, lousy, destitute Mexicans arriving at El Paso daily will undoubtedly bring and spread typhus unless a quarantine is placed at once.
This anti-Mexican sentiment was reflected in government policy and in jails. Crude methods of disinfection began, including the soaking of Mexican prisoners in gasoline, often resulting in tragedy.
A flash of flame burst from tanks in which prisoners, including Mexicans, were being given disinfecting baths in the campaign to prevent the spread of disease from Mexico. A match lighted by one of the bathers, in disregard of orders, was said to have caused the explosion.
On January 24th, 1917, El Paso announced a full quarantine of Mexican immigrants from Juarez.
All persons entering El Paso from Mexico between the hours of 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. will be subject to quarantine inspection and disinfection of their person and effects when considered necessary or advisable by the quarantine officer.
This political and physical barrier went into effect a mere 3 days later, alongside a government-instituted disinfection plan. For Mexican immigrants, the effects of this political and physical barrier were immediate and harsh.
They're first going to be segregated by sex when they go into the facility. They're going to be forced to strip naked. Their clothes are going to be taken away from them, and they're going to be chemically scoured. They're going to be laundered. And what they're doing is they're checking for lice.
Some Mexicans willingly went through the baths multiple times a day in hopes of selling border tickets to others who were desperate to evade the humiliation at the border. Rumors even broke out that the health personnel were photographing the nude bathers and spreading their pictures throughout the town. One woman, Carmelita Torres, was enraged by these humiliating barriers to Mexican women. Carmelita was a 17-year-old Mexican maid who lived in Juarez and crossed into El Paso every day to work. She resisted. Later, the American people would come to know her as the auburn-haired Amazon due to her fiery hair and passion. At 7:30 a.m. on January 28, 1917, only 1 day after the quarantine was implemented, a riot broke out at the Santa Fe Bridge border crossing. At the center of the riot was Carmelita Torres, whose sparks ignited a flame that roared across the city. Over 200 women stood by her side, throwing bottles and rocks at officers, blocking traffic and any streetcars that attempted to pass. Backlash to the riots was severe. Newspapers referred to the protests as assaults, depicting the officers at the scene as heroes and calling the general scene laughable. Despite the ridiculing of the bath riots, the event empowered Mexican immigrants to protest the societal barriers built against them on both sides of the border, despite having to live through one of the worst anti-immigrant periods in the world. After the Bath Riots, Mexican immigrants felt empowered to band together to emerge from privacy and fight against the barriers placed against them. One prominent organization that did exactly this was the Orden Hijos de América, a San Antonio-based group that was created in 1921 and set out to influence all fields of social, economic, and political action in order to realize the greatest enjoyment possible of the rights extended by the American Constitution. The Orden successfully desegregated beaches, schools, and housing projects, as well as helping to place the first ever Mexican-American on a jury in 1927. Back in Mexico, Carmelita Torres's courage was also a key moment in the rising Mexican feminist movement to break gendered social barriers. One prominent example was a law passed in Mexico the very same year as the Bath Riots, the Law of Family Relations. The law gave women the right to receive alimony, to own property, to take part in legal suits, and to have the same rights of men in cases of child custody. This law broke significant economic and legal barriers for Mexican women, and was passed largely due to the activism of Mexican women in Mexico City. In another instance, Hermila Galindo, a Mexican feminist activist, presented demands of suffrage in front of an all-male assembly at the 1917 Constitutional Convention. Unfortunately, these changes would not last. Women like Carmelita were suppressed and even silenced from history.
We just don't know much about her. And that, you know, here's a person that we know about one incident that she is responsible for, and then she's been lost to history, as so many people are who are not elites, that don't come from the majority population. We just know very little about them.
Despite the efforts of activists and freedom fighters like Carmelita Torres, widespread discriminatory barriers against immigrants continue into the modern era. Under the current administration, barriers for Mexican immigrants are still very much in place at the highest level.
These ideas about Mexicans are something that have been around for more than 100 years. They're deeply ingrained in the kind of discourse in general in the United States.
They're sending people that have lots of problems, and they're bringing those problems with us. They're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime, they're rapists, and some, I assume, are good people.
Although there's been no significant construction on a wall, the Trump administration is creating new barriers against immigrations along the Mexican-American border. One of its most controversial moves is the mass detention of migrant families who tried to enter the country, including the separation of children from their parents. Not only are these barriers racially charged and damaging to child development, they are also illegal. In July 2017, U.S. District Judge Dolly G found the Trump administration had breached the 1997 Flores Agreement by not providing migrant children with appropriate food or hygienic supplies, housing them in cold facilities without beds. In 1917, Mexican immigrants entering the border were forced through detention camps in inhumane conditions. A century later, the exact same thing is occurring. A grim piece of the past revived in the present.
The only way that you can institute controls by coming up with new mechanism, whether it be delousing and bathing and all of that, to discourage them from coming over, or coming up with, you know, discriminatory housing practices and not letting people get an education. The only way that you can do that is through laws, right? I think the same thing is going on today.
Luckily, in 2020, activists like Carmelita Torres are no longer an anomaly. While the Bath Riots were an isolated incident in a long chain of unbroken barriers, injustice today is recognized and called out for what it is. Millions of Latina women are now empowered to stand up against the social and racial barriers deeply ingrained in American society against immigrants. One such woman is Zaira Livier, the founder of the People's Defense Initiative, a grassroots nonprofit in Tucson. In recent years, they have successfully lobbied for sanctuary status to be considered in Tucson and have conducted several demonstrations against SB 1070, an oppressive legal and social barrier that gives police the ability to stop and interrogate any Mexican-American within reasonable suspicion. The PDI also protests for LGBTQ and women's rights, making it the perfect intersection of feminism and immigrant activism for which Carmelita Torres stood. Carmelita Torres helped crack barriers of anti-immigrant sentiment in the early 20th century, and as the 21st century progresses, that crack will be the source of a complete collapse.